This morning we're starting a series called You Can't Judge a Gift by Its Wrapping. You can't judge a gift by its wrapping. There are some people who are really particular about the way they wrap gifts. How many have someone like that in your house? Yeah. And there are even YouTube videos which make look beautiful gift wrapping so easy until you try it. And then you find out it's not as easy as it looks. There are other people who it seems that the only qualification that they have is that most of the gift is covered in some way. And you might be surprised to discover that there's actually a study out that says that people who get poorly wrapped gifts enjoy the gifts more. Yeah, their expectation level was put so low by the wrapping that they were really surprised when it was a really good gift. God gives gifts to us. And if we were to assess the value of the gift based on how it's wrapped, we might not even open it, which explains what happens sometimes. As it turns out, God is not a good gift wrapper. He is an amazing gift giver. And so we're going to look at the gift of guidance. How does God guide us? And we're in Psalm 32 in verse 8, and it says, I will instruct you and teach you in the way that you should go. I will counsel you with my loving eye on you. Do not be like the horse or the mule, which have no understanding, but must be controlled by bit and bridle, or they will not come to you. Many are the woes of the wicked, but the Lord's unfailing love surrounds the one who trusts in him. Rejoice in the Lord and be glad, you righteous. Sing, all you who are upright in heart. The context of this passage, if you read the previous verses, is actually confession and forgiveness. And that's important because none of us are perfect. We all have our weaknesses, we all have our faults, we all have our failures, and hiding our faults and failures actually doesn't do anything to help or heal us. It's when we begin to bring our faults and failures out into the light that then we can experience the power of forgiveness. But once forgiven, what does that mean? Are we just kind of stuck where we are? Or are we just prone to wander the same way we did prior to experiencing the forgiveness of God? And the challenge about the wandering option is that we usually wind up back in very similar places to where we have been before. We tend to be tempted by the same things. You see, temptation is not an accident that happens to you. Temptation is a longing revealed in you. That's a very powerful truth. And David, who's the poet that wrote this song, indicates that the best follow-up option to forgiveness, once we've confessed and we're forgiven, is to seek God's guidance. And God's guidance comes wrapped in different ways. And in the Christmas story, we see an amazing example of this. In the Christmas story, there are all kinds of guidance that are provided in all kinds of ways. For example, the Magi received the gift of guidance. It started by coming across an ancient text in the land that they lived in, and it was discovered that it was foretold that there would be a Messiah that would be born, and there would be something that would occur in the heavens. There would be an anomaly, a signal that the Messiah was born. And between their knowledge of astronomy and their knowledge of math, they actually recognized something in the sky that was different. I mean, quite honestly, if there was a different star in the sky tonight, would any of you notice? And we would say, probably wouldn't see it because the cloud cover of our region is just so high. They began a really long journey to find this Christ child. And their goal was to worship him when they found him. Along the way, they actually had to make adjustments in their journey in terms of its direction based on the calculations they were running regarding this star that they were seeing. were some clouds that rolled into their horizon, and they lost sight of the star. And when they lost sight of it, they stopped in a nearby city, which was Jerusalem. And they wanted to go to the palace because they assumed that the king of the realm would probably know something about this. What they discovered was that there was a political leader who had more insecurity than answers. And so they did ask for some religious scholars, and the religious scholars combed through the prophetic texts of Scripture to see if there were clues about where the Christ child would be born. And they said, yes, the answer is in Bethlehem. So the Magi headed in that direction. And when the clouds rolled off the horizon, what they saw was a star confirming what Scripture had foretold. And it tells us that they rejoiced with great joy. When they found the Christ child, they worship, because that's what all wise people do. As they prepared for their return trip, they actually had a dream. Herod had asked them to return and tell him where the Christ child was found so that he too could go and worship. But in a dream that they were warned that they should not go back by way of Herod and to go home by a different route. Not easy to do in the ancient world. They didn't have the kind of GPS capacity that we have in our phones and in our cars that we can just recalculate very easily. But they did that. They went home by another route. A series of gifts, all strangely wrapped in guidance. What was your favorite guidance wrapping that I just covered? Reading ancient texts and finding clues. Stargazing. How about calculating direction and location? How about conversations with political and religious leaders? How about prophecy from Scripture? How about dreams? God's guidance, all wrapped in different ways. Yeah. Or the shepherds, they also received a gift of guidance. The shepherds who were spending the night in the fields were sent on a treasure hunt. A blazing light and an angelic concert didn't just startle them. It absolutely terrified them. But something else happened too. It awoken something in them. And that was wonder. Minimum wage workers pulling a night shift are not usually the people we assume are going to have information given to them from God. But this is the God we're dealing with. Aren't you glad? He decides who he's going to talk to. Yeah. This is the God we're dealing with. This guidance was not a warning. It was actually an invitation. It was not bad news. It was incredibly good news. A messenger angel gave them the clues to look for in finding the Christ child. There would be a baby. He would be wrapped in cloths. He would be lying in a manger. And they heard a song. And the song was glory to God and peace on earth. Not a tune we hear a lot today. If you want something other than to enter into God's glory, you're always going to get something other than peace on earth. It's just how it works. And so the one essential thing that is absolutely necessary for guidance is actually following it when you get it. And the shepherds did that. They could have built a campfire and just retold their angelic encounter story over and over, or they could go actually find the Christ child, and they chose Savior seeking over sheep watching. They showed baby finding over storytelling. And they didn't do it because they were bored with their job. They did it because they were commissioned by angels to be participants in this amazing story. And when they saw the Christ child, they were astonished because it was exactly as they were told. And now it wasn't just the angels who were rejoicing. It was shepherds who were rejoicing too. A gift of guidance, strangely wrapped. What was your favorite guidance wrapping in this story? Angelic messengers? Flashing lights? Music? A treasure hunt? Amazing gifts, strangely wrapped. Joseph was also given a gift of guidance. An angel appeared to him in a dream and told him to get up and take the mother and the child and escape to Egypt and to stay there until the angel came back in another dream and told him it was safe to go home again. Escape is the option that they were told to take. They weren't told to stand still and see the glory of the Lord this time. Some people think that because that appeared once in the Bible, that's always your position. This angel said, get up and get out. Run for your life. And Joseph did what anyone would do if you took that guidance seriously. He got up in the middle of the night with Mary and Joseph, and they left for Egypt. Short notice, life and death situation. A sense of urgency would be an understatement to describe their actions in that moment. And Joseph and Mary and Jesus wind up becoming refugees in a foreign country. The gift of guidance, very strangely wrapped. We all need God's guidance because we are all prone to wander. We all need God's guidance because we are all prone to wander. All humans, regardless of your education, regardless of your socioeconomic status, regardless of your ethnicity, we're all prone to wander. Left to our own, we are easily distracted by desirable things. Left to our own, we are easily deceived by empty promises. Left to our own, we are easily outraged by anything and anyone that's different than us. And distracted, deceived, and outraged people all have something in common. Sin. We've all been bitten by that. The path of least resistance leads us to sin. The path of pursuing pleasure leads us to sin. The path of trying to control others and outcomes leads us to sin. And because of Christmas, we actually have another option to those paths. Something different than just our own natural pursuits or our gradual wanderings. We can follow the guidance of God, and he's the one who leads us to repentance, and he's the one who leads us to wonder, and he's the one who leads us to worship, and he's the one who leads us to love. He leads us to those we would rather avoid. He leads us to let go of what we'd rather hang on to. He leads us to pay attention to what we would rather ignore. How many are grateful for the guidance of God, regardless of how it comes wrapped? Amen? I'm going to have worship team come out. God has so many ways to wrap his guidance. He gives us his son. This is important. There are no misfit people that he misleads away from Jesus, because to mislead them from Jesus would also mislead them from himself. This is what Jesus would say in John 14. Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. If your version of God or your vision of God looks different than Jesus, then you've misunderstood God. You've misread a text. God leads us to Jesus. In Hebrews 1, it says this, the Son of the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being. If you want to know about Jesus, he's the exact representation of God's being. And in Christ, the price for all of our faults and all of our failures are paid in full. Now, I know what some people think. Well, you don't need to. Why does anybody have to pay anything? Just forgive. Just forgive. Why can't God just kind of forgive everybody? So let's say that while you and I are leaving the building this morning, you dropped the donut that you got out of this place. And when it went down onto the floor, you lost track of what was going on in front of your car. And while you were grabbing the donut, you actually ran right into my car. And let's suppose that we got out and I didn't yell, I didn't scream, I didn't swear. And let's suppose that you said, oh, Pastor, I'm so sorry. I was distracted by the donut. You shouldn't have donuts. And I could say this, don't worry about it. And you could offer to pay. And I would say, I'm not interested in accepting any payment. And this is the forgiveness everybody wants from God. And it's the forgiveness he doesn't offer. Because if nobody pays the price, the car stays damaged. And you drive around in this dented, broken, barely usable thing. If the car's going to be fixed, somebody has to pay for it. And what God says is, yes, you did the damage, and you were distracted by way more than donuts. And I'll pay for it. And not only does that mean you don't have to pay, but he pays the price not only for our reconnection with him, our redemption, but for our restoration, that we can become what he always intended for us, that the damage that has been done is not permanent. Hear that. Whatever damage you've experienced in your life, it's not permanent. He also leads us to growth and development. We tend to focus on location, where we want to be. What if you couldn't grow and develop in the place you preferred to be? Would that be enough for you to reconsider guidance options? See, God wants to grow your character. He wants to grow your empathy. He wants to grow your giftedness. He wants to grow your capacity to have a quiet confidence in the midst of very troubling situations. He wants to expand your capacity to love others. He wants to put something inside of you that maintains serenity, even when all around you is troubled. He wants to increase your capacity to enter into the joy of others and to experience joy for yourselves. He wants to help us to be more patient. None of us want to be more patient, but how much is that needed in our world? And to expand our capacity to respond in kind and loving ways in a broken, dark, and very unkind world. See, will you allow God to guide you to those places? Or will you insist on a zip code or a climate preference or a specific school? Or a coveted title, or a certain amount of square footage, or the preferred label or brand, the relationship status you prefer. These are the actual choices we all make. And God's guidance has something to say in every one of them. God provides guidance in a way, in the way, and to the place that he chooses. It is unwise to go to God and say, I'd like you to guide me to the place I want to go. The place he will take you is much better. So why would we trust his guidance? Because he's the only one who, when he saw the distance between us and those created, between him and those created in his image and likeness, he thought it intolerable. And he decided to do something about it. He's the only one who would actually completely underwrite and subsidize the cost of our redemption and our restoration. He's the only one who loves us more than anyone. He's the only one who's the most generous being in the world, and he doesn't use us as an excuse to not be generous. He's the only one who's given more than anyone, who sees us better than anyone, and still sees our potential better than anyone. How many would like heaven to be guiding you rather than all the voices on earth? So will you open your life to his guidance today? And maybe for you, the guidance is a decision to come to him. Not just to include God in your life, but to make him the leader of your life. Not just to say, I come to sit at the table to negotiate the terms of what I want, but to say, I'd be interested in spending the next season of my life finding out what you want for me. That could be the greatest adventure of all. Let's bow our heads. Father, the truth is that we were very nearsighted and we have difficulty staying on track even when we know the way we should go. We don't ask for your guidance because we think we're good. We ask for your guidance because we know where we can go without it. And that brings fear and concern to each and every one of us. But your commitment to us is not only as we bring our faults and failures out into the light that you will forgive us, but that you will lead us and guide us in all the ways that we should go. And you choose lots of different wrappings for that guidance. Help us to be open to every one of them so that we can experience all the leadings, all the guidings, all the promptings that heaven has for us. We thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's all stand together.